But I remember a song that my grandmother used to sing. If you guys just bear with me for a moment, I want to sing at least one verse of that song. The name of it is Just a Closer Walk with Thee. How many of you want to have a closer walk with me? Just a closer walk with Thee.
At the sound of the music, and worship, and everybody were on their knees worshiping, except three boys. These are not young men. They are three boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore, it must be right. What was in them that kept them from bowing down? They heard the music. They probably enjoyed the sound of the flute, the harp, and the sackbut. But what kept them from bowing? They was reported to the king. He was angry at their refusal. But he gave them, you know, earlier today, the piano player told us something. I don't know who called him. He said, we serve a God of second chance.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
Of second chance. Mm-hmm. Amen. So the king gave them a second chance. He said, bow down . But they would still not bow. They would not bow. What is it about these boys? They say, we hear what you say, O king, but we will not bow. The king said, well, the result of that, of not bowing, is to burn. Is to burn. They said, listen to this. They said, they rather burn temporarily than to burn for eternity.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
What a statement. We temporarily sometimes do things for the pleasure of it. But there is no long-term benefit in it. See, we got to learn to stand firm on our belief. The word tells us, when the enemy come at you like a storm, the scripture tells me that the Lord said, I will build up a standard. All we got to do is stand still and watch the salvation of the Lord. What kept them from bowing? I like to believe that they were able to withstand the pressure of Babylon because of what they learned at home in Jerusalem.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said?
Mm-hmm.
They was able to stand the pressure in Babylon because of what they learned at home in Jerusalem.
Amen.
Somewhere at home, their mother, their papa, their preacher, the church, or the community put something in them that kept them from bowing.
Yes.
But our problem as parents sometimes is we want to start teaching our children once they get in Babylon, but it is too late. When they get in Babylon, we want to wait until they pick up an addiction or get into trouble and then tell them about Jesus. It's too late to do it at that point. You don't start preaching in Babylon. You start preparing in Jerusalem. And for you and I, our Jerusalem is in our homes.
Amen, amen.
We start preparing our children within our homes. So when they get to Babylon, glory be to God, they can handle the pressure.
Yeah.
See, these three young men, young boys, their mothers was not there. Their fathers was not there. They were there by themselves. They could have bowed.
Yeah.
Did you hear me? They could have bowed. And no one would have known except God. Well, let's bring it home.
All right now. Come on.
We can do like a lot of people in the church. They go through the ritual and the ceremony. But you can look like you are bowing before the eternal God and get up and walk as crooked as you were before you got there. But these boys were not trying to be religious pretenders. They were saying to the king, regardless to the pressure you put on us, we are not going to bow, and you sure can't make us break. Because there is something in us bigger than you outside of us. I want to believe they could handle Babylon because of what were taught to them in Jerusalem. Before they ever knew, they would be captive in Babylon. Somebody at home in Jerusalem, their mothers or fathers, along with the church and the ministers, taught them early on, Exodus 20, thou shalt have no other God beside me. Somewhere they were taught not to bow down to any graven images. They had learned, train up a child in the way that they should go. And when they get older, they will not depart from it. Amen. Somebody taught them, remember thou now your creator in the days of thy youth. When the evil days draw nigh, when you say I have no pleasure in, I'm still amazed at some of us. We get more excited about our children scoring a high academic score than we do their Christian development. We are happier if they can throw a football, dunk a basketball, run track. Don't we know the body shall fade away? What I'm talking about now is the preservation of that part of them that shall live forever.
Amen.
Amen.
We better wake up, church, because there is a battle for the minds of our young people. The church is the only ingrate folks in the community. We will mistreat our children sometimes, but the world say, we will give you what you want so we can buy the best part of you. That's why they start singing in the choir and go and make money in the world and never get back to the church. See, we have to put something inside of them so if they get hired from the choir and make big on the stage, but on Sunday morning, they still come. And they still know from whence they have come from. You don't want to raise children up. The only time they come to Jesus is like we did sometimes. I'm in trouble. I've lost my job. My marriage is falling apart. You want to raise babes up now that know that God has kept you and God has sustained you and God has been holding you and God has been leading you. We will not bow down. That's what they said. They are not grown. They are just children. We are not bowing down. We learn what the scripture said long time ago. O King, our God is able to deliver us. He can rescue us if he want to. But I want you to know something. If he chooses not to, he's still able to. Where did that courage come from? They must have seen it in their parents. They must remember Israel when they were in Egypt in slavery. They did not bow then. We are not going to break now. They did not bow in the past. And we are not going to bend in the present. Yeah. You have to pass down. You and I, we have to pass down our stories. I know what it means to be where you are, talking to our children. Too many of us, when we come to Jesus, we try to act like we always been walking with Jesus. Some of us in here, we know we have some bad history. Amen. We have made some mistakes. Amen. We need to stop trying to act like we are something we are not. Yeah. And tell our children, I know what it means to come up against the temptation of sexuality. I know what it means that somebody wants you to snort, shoot, or smoke. Then tell them, I have not always been like I am. But I had somebody that put something in me. So when I came to Babylon, I did not have to crumble. O King, I want to tell you something. We will not bow down, and our God is able to deliver us. He can rescue us if he wants to. I want you to know, if he chooses not, he can still
amen.
Oh, we need to grasp that today, brothers and sisters. Even if God does not come and do what we think we want, what he should do for us, it doesn't mean that he can't do it. He is still able to do it. It either means that we are not ready for it or he is not ready to reveal it to us. Where did they get that kind of confidence from? Because they heard stories in Jerusalem that he may not come when you want him. But he's always on time. Somehow in church, they heard their parents say, "The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want." They heard somebody saying, "I will lift up my eyes into the hills. My help cometh from the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth. He will not let my foot be moved." They heard in the church how good and pleasant it is for us to dwell together in unity. They heard in the church, "My feet almost slipped, but then I looked around and the Lord was there to hold me up." Glory be to God. So when they came to Babylon, my mother told me there'd be days like this. This, and now they have come upon me. You can't make me bend, you can't make me bow, and you can't break me. I know you can burn us up, but our God is able to deliver us. But if not, where did they get this "if not" from? Where did it come from? See, you got to put some "if not" faith in our children. If God don't heal you, if God don't deliver you, if God doesn't give you the job you want, if you don't make the team you want to play on, if you don't score high on the test, God is still able to make a way out of no way.
Yeah.
I am still going to trust in him anyway. Have you ever had "if not" faith? You know the Lord is able to do it, but you do not understand why he did not. But when you look around over your life, even if the Lord does not show up, I will still trust him. Because when I look at my life, all of my good days outweigh all of my bad days. Because if it had not been for the Lord, where would I be? See, let me tell you something. If you don't bow and you don't bend, you won't burn. Did you hear what I said? If you won't bow and you don't bend, you won't burn. The king can't sleep. He said, "Take me to the furnace." The next morning, when he got there, he looked in the flames. They are walking around. The king saw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walking around in the flames with their hands untied. Glory. Untied. He said, "Didn't we throw three in the furnace?" The legend says to get in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And Raphael showed up and said, Lord, I go. How long will it take to get there, God asked. He said, 1 second. He said, that's too long. Raphael came, Lord, I go. I can get there in a half a second. No, that's too long. Gabriel said, I have been your adversary for a long time. I can get there in a tenth of a second. Oh no, that's too long. They said, how are we going to get them out? How long, Lord, will it take you to get there? He said, I'm already in the flame. I'm already in the flame. See, when you go through the flames and the fires of life, the Lord is already there. We ought to rejoice and thank Him for being there. Have I got a witness in here today? Yeah.